right, everyone, welcome back to Master of the Universe podcast. It's showtime. Got the old J-Man, Mr. Korean Food Karam, and Mr. Gabriel tonight, man. How y'all motherfuckers doing, man?
Doing all right. Chris, not too bad.
Chris like,
I'm realizing the kimchi is not for me, but some of their other stuff is.
That's pretty good, man. I've been wanting to try Korean food, but just haven't done so yet. But, you know, maybe one day, dude. So tonight we're talking about 2021's Mortal Kombat, dude. So everyone, you know, everyone should know Mortal Kombat, but I know us, we grew up in the Mortal Kombat age during the arcade stuff. So I know everyone's got a Mortal Kombat story that's our age. So Gabe, dude, you know, what's your history with the game and movies prior to this?
Ooh, man, I was Mortal Kombat obsessed. I don't play too much video games nowadays, but when I did, I played nothing but a whole bunch of fighting video games. It was mostly fighting video games and like these little RPG stories, you know, PlayStation and all that. But Mortal Kombat, though, was definitely like it had its own deal here, you know, separate from Street Fighter, separate from Soul Calibur, separate from Tekken. I mean, this game was just badass all on its own because of those fatalities.
Yep. So badass, John McCain tried to get it banned.
Yeah, there was a lot of Republican bullshit back then. I remember that. Yeah, the Republicans were hating video games at the time, right?
Yeah, and I think that's what started off that whole rating system too, right? For the video games on this.
You're right. Yeah, I remember. You know, because I always say, like, oh, one side's got good points, one side's got good points, but I always laugh at the Republican part where they're like, video games turn people into murderers. I'm like, well, what about movies? And what about you? If you're to say that about that, I mean, that's like everything else. But anyway, go ahead.
I mean, well, just to give some background, like, I kid you not, like, when I was younger, you know, right there every Friday, you know, my parents would go ahead and, you know, they needed their break, you know, just from everything, work and or whatever. So my old man would go ahead and go to the pool hall. He loved going to the pool halls. And then there was my mom. She's loved going to bingo. That was her thing too. So they gave me a choice. They're all, you want to go with your old man or you want to go with your mom? Well, I'm going to go with the old man because they got a bunch of arcades where he's at. So he's off on the side getting drunk, having a great time. And me, I got like 10 bucks. 20 bucks in my pocket, and here I am, I'm like sticking quarters in these damn arcade machines, and Mortal Kombat was definitely one of them. So,
which,
sure
in
enough,
1994, you could still play a game for a quarter.
Oh, yeah, man, well, of course. I mean, you had them all lined up on the edge. If you had them, if you were going to be there a while, you go ahead and line up your quarters right there on the top. If there was a line, then you would just play until someone loses, and then, you know, you're out. But either day, you just go ahead and line up all your quarters right there on the edge of the screen. And pretty much that kind of showed that you were going to be there for a while. And sure enough, I always end up getting those people that always ended up, like, I didn't have kids to play, like, that were my age because I was in the bar. So I would always get, like, these drunk dudes that would come out of nowhere. What are you playing? What are you doing here? I'm like, dude, my old man's here, man. I'm just chilling playing this game. Well, I'm going to play this game. What do I do? Well, this is punch, this is block. Seriously, and the first thing that they all go for, and I always end up playing everybody, they always end up picking Scorpion. And Scorpion, that's like everyone's main guy, so I always had to pick Sub-Zero because I don't want to be no Scorpion because everyone's Scorpion. So I'm either Sub-Zero or I'm Sonya. Two of my favorite characters out of this whole damn game. and then when it came time for it, fatality, you know, ripping their hearts out, freezing them, ripping their heads off with their spine. I mean, that's what made this game fantastic.
Yeah, seeing blood, I mean, I know, you know, for me as a kid, seeing blood in a video game, like, was, like, crazy. And then to see that there were, like, that, I mean, I don't know what it is, we call it stop motion or whatever, like, they actually had the actual people, like, doing all the stuff like in the video game, so there were actual people, not just some, like, you know, it didn't look like a video game, it looked like real life. So that those combinations of things was like crazy. The first time I actually saw the game, I went to one of my cousin's house and they were playing it on the Sega, and I was like, what the fuck is this? And I was completely blown away, and I was like, you know, what are their names? And when I first, I always remember it, because, like, you know when you're a kid, you're hearing, like, you don't hear things as well what, like, people are saying if you don't know the word or whatever. So I was like, well, who's this guy? And, like, because I liked Kano, because he had, like, almost like a Terminator kind of face. And they were like, they were saying, oh, that's Kano. But, I mean, for me being that young, I was like, yeah, that didn't make sense. I was like, Potato? That's Potato? So I would call him Potato for a little bit, dude. It's like, Potato, that's pretty good. But for me, I was always Sub-Zero as a kid. I was always, that was my go-to, because I just, you know, now I'm a Scorpion fan, but as a kid growing up, I was always Sub-Zero, always, and then Raiden a few times. But Chris, what's your Mortal Kombat, you know, history, dude?
Oh, fuck, man. Like my, okay, so I didn't have a Sega Genesis, didn't get a Super Nintendo till like middle school, honestly, so... And I don't mean sixth grade, I mean like I think seventh grade we got our first Super Nintendo, so I would always, for me it was always going over to friends' houses, usually my next door neighbor's house, and we'd play it. But fucking A, like at first, fifth grade is when it came out, and at first like everyone was all up on Sub-Zero, like when it first came out, people first started playing it, like no one could figure out how to beat Sub-Zero, and then after a few months like everyone started figuring out, and then he was just another guy. But It kind of like this movie has that feel of how we felt as fifth graders trying to beat Sub-Zero when the game first came out.
I remember trying to learn the fatalities and like hearing, like, you know, that schoolyard, like you know people would talk about, oh, you know, like the same thing with wrestling. It was like, oh, well, you can do this kind of move on there, and you're like, no way. And I forgot, like, I don't know how I did it. I you know, because sometimes if you like the fatalities, you would just, like, if you, it was very rare, but if you just kind of button mashed, you might be able to do one. And I remember, I don't know how, but I got, like, a code from somewhere way back when. And I did it, and I was like, oh, my God, like, this is so badass. It felt like, you know, like I passed some kind of test or something back then, like being able to pull off a fatality. It was, like, the most over-ass thing in the business. So, and then Mortal Kombat 2 came out. That I remember going to the video store to like rent games and stuff, and seeing like they had the cover, but the game wasn't behind it. So I remember seeing it for like months, and then finally being able to play Mortal Kombat 2, and that game was really tough, man. Much harder than the first one.
Okay. Mortal Kombat 2. I didn't come across that until Christmas break of sixth grade, and I went over. Remember at my wedding that older guy, blonde bald guy, he was walking out. I was joking with his wife about like the donuts when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. Tony Montano.
Yeah.
So this guy, like, we would go over to his house like twice a year, you know, and he had this house that was like always a work in progress, a big huge mansion out in Garden Ridge, and it was always being worked on, always renovating something, always adding on something. Well, his son, who was my age,
yeah,
had this bad dude. This is like the kind of bedroom like the cool kid would have on like 90s sitcoms. I mean, he had this fucking bedroom. It was bad fucking ass. And in it, he had like every fucking game system, every fucking new toy and everything. And we're in sixth grade, and the kid's name was Mark. And we're there, and I had never played Mortal Kombat 2, and he puts it on. I'm seeing all these characters, like the twin sisters, one's got the Psy, one's got the fans, and then Kung Lao, and then fucking Reptile's a main character now, and there's a couple other people I hadn't seen before, and I'm like, fucking, hey, this is on a whole nother level.
Yeah, for sure. Part 2 had a lot more characters. It was, I mean, like, I really liked Part 1, but Part 2 got everything and really amplified it, and Part 3 added more characters, added a little bit different stuff, but... Let's talk about the release of this film, man. So, after the first two films came out, you know, they're being like, we'll eventually get to those. But, you know, doing this one, I was still a fan of the original too, even though, like, Part 2 is, like, kind of, like, over-the-top ridiculous and cheesy and bad acting, all that shit. Still enjoy it. And so when I heard they were going to make, you know, a sequel, or not a sequel, but, like, another remake, basically, of it, I was all like, okay, you know, that'll be badass. But it was always kind of in the works. Did y'all hear about the same thing, and it was, just felt like it was never going to come out?
Yeah, definitely. I definitely heard a little. I heard little things like, oh yeah, it was in the works. It's in the process. They're making it, and I'm like, I didn't think much of it. The idea of it was like, yeah, that's going to be bad. I'd like to see a more modern, you know, take on Mortal Kombat, since the old one was, what, 1995?
Yeah.
So ever since, like, that original one, that one was just badass on its own. But then they said they were going to do a remake. So I took it lighthearted only because usually things happen for some reason or other. The director can't do this or whatever, and things usually fall through. And so I honestly did not expect it until the trailer started coming out.
Yeah.
So once that came out, then I was like, oh, snap, like seeing Sub-Zero just whooping ass and freezing things and Scorpion and all that. Yeah, it was just, I just, then my expectations like jumped up really high for this movie.
Yeah, did you keep up with anything, Chris, or when did you find out when this was coming out? It was just kind of like hit you like, whoa, they're making another one?
I think it was honestly when you and your brother showed me the trailer when we were hanging out.
Oh, no shit. Yeah, I had. I'm a big James Wan fan when he used to make a lot of films, but now he's kind of like chilled out. But I had heard he was going to be a part of this and like possibly direct it. I wasn't sure if he was, but like, of course, like, you know, like Gabe was saying, things change and one way or another, someone's in and someone's out. And I had heard like around 2015 or 16 or something like that he was going to do it. And it was kind of like, well, you're waiting and you're waiting, and then you just kind of like give up and you forgot about it. And then I forgot where I saw the news that, oh, it's like I saw it somewhere, like, oh, when HBO was saying that they were going to, HBO Max was saying they're going to start releasing, you know, these films on the app instead of like, well, also on theater. And I saw Godzilla was like one of the films, and I was like, badass, you know, Godzilla versus Kong or Kong versus Godzilla. And I saw Mortal Kombat. I'm like, holy shit, it's actually gonna come out. I couldn't believe it, because I had heard of it, but I don't know it was actually out now, because I'd heard like, oh, they're doing it and James Wan's attached and all this and that. And then, yeah, when I saw the trailer, dude, I was like, oh man, this looks good. And yeah, then we saw it. Then we saw it. Did we see? Oh yeah, we did see it all together, right? Right, Chris?
Yeah, me, you, Rose, Danny, at your brother's house, and we watched it twice that night. I remember.
That's how over it is. How many times have you seen this movie, Gabe?
Oh, I saw it at least three times. The wife was actually more excited. She seemed more excited about the movie than I was.
Damn.
And she was like, are we going to watch it? I was like, yeah, we're going to watch it. Should we get some beers or something? I was like, let's chill out. I mean, like, first let's get all our stuff situated first, and then we'll sit down. We're going to watch this movie. And, sure enough, we watched it. It was pretty good, and, you know, we were picking it apart, you know. I was already telling her, I was like, oh man, that's Sonya. That's a pretty girl right there.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
I'm just putting that out there, you know.
Can I just say, or are we getting started on the story yet, or are we just
We're always getting started, Daddy, but go ahead.
Dude, you know, I gotta say, like, I didn't see the 95 and 97 movies. Like, I saw clips of them at the time, and I would see the trailers and shit, but I didn't actually see them. So, like, I kind of had a feel for what it was, but I didn't really know. I hadn't seen it. But here I watch this, and when they get to the end of the first scene, I see Raiden just this fucking, like, I mean, like, we joke and say deity, but I mean, this is fucking, like, this guy is fucking, like, all-powerful. He's just owning his environment, and he just teleports wherever he wants, like he's going from his apartment to the gym or some shit like that.
I was going to say, is he in a DeLorean, or what's, why is he able to just do that?
I know, man, he's like fucking this shit, fuck Doc Brown, man, this guy controls all that shit. But and he just takes the baby, and he's teleporting with lightning and all this. I'm like, oh my lord, like, I didn't know, because I remember the game, and yeah. I remember Raiden was a badass character, but I didn't know he was some god.
Oh, so, like, when you're seeing this, you're like, okay, what the fuck's going on? So I get you now. So, yeah, so you still haven't seen, well, you've never seen the original ones?
No, and after seeing this, I watched the, you know, that fan clip, movie clips channel?
Yeah.
I saw like all 10 of those videos. I was like, that's a badass fucking movie. Why did I miss it? But I mean, yeah, I thought Raiden just, I popped for that. That dude was fucking presented excellently.
Did Gabe, have you seen the two movies prior to this, the Mortal Kombat? I know there's like another like spinoff or whatever, but the two.
Right, Annihilation and the other, of course, yeah.
Okay.
Like I said, I was Mortal Kombat obsessed, so.
Yeah, me too. No, I'm asking because when we're going to do this, I was going to try to compare the characters from the originals a little bit, you know, but I'm not going to do that with Chris. You know, obviously we'll wait till we do all that stuff, but go ahead, man. What were you saying about the obsession?
Oh, man. So, yeah, like I was saying, I was definitely Mortal Kombat obsessed. So anything and everything, to a T-shirt, to like the soundtrack, to all kinds of stuff like that has anything to do with Mortal Kombat. I mean, this is what I was talking in school, like any which way I could. I was like, you know, the damn magazines too. They were all Mortal Kombat. It had like the official guy that told you like, hey, you know, push this for, you know, to do a special combo. And you know it. Honestly, like I didn't even really start figuring out that there was a story to this. Like, even though as much as I was playing it, I was not reading anything about, you know, like it would pop up like during like the loading scenes, or not the loading, but in the arcade version, like when it was just playing by itself.
Yeah, it would be idle, right? Doing like thing. Yeah,
it'll go ahead and give like a little brief history of like what Mortal Kombat is about. Honestly, I didn't even figure out anything until like later on. I was like, oh, there's a backstory to this? I thought we were just fighting and just trying to kill each other.
Yeah, exactly. This is a video game that eventually became a movie or a series of movies. And then the opposite dynamic is you have movies that eventually try to become a successful video game, and a lot of times when it goes that way, it fails. But when you have a video game that then becomes a movie with a good story and everything, people are interested. They want to see, well, how are they going to work this? How are they going to angle this?
Right. Now, I mean, kind of going into this movie, by any chance, when y'all were playing the games, and now that y'all are aware that there's a storyline, have y'all been playing any of the recent video games, especially more so the last newest Mortal Kombat that's, you know, that's kind of going out right now? Do y'all know anything about that story? I have the video game, and I did play the whole storyline. I just want to touch bases to see if y'all can make if y'all know the differences or the comparisons between the damn game story and then this damn movie. It was better than the other one, that White Claw.
Oh, yeah, fuck all that.
That was actually better than that one, though.
Yeah, the Trulies, they have the lemonade ones. The best ones, the strawberry lemonade, and then it's like black cherry. They have those ones, and they're all like, mm-hmm. Yeah, like those, you can just enjoy them. Because Trulies has like, it's like standard flavor. It's like a white one. They were those kind of, I mean, I like them, but I'm not going to, try those out. Like, I like those, but. They have these new fruit punch ones. Oh my god, dude! They're gonna be the go to bag, but
You know what though? Well, did you tell Chris what I had sent you that they had those drinking games with the damn movies?
Oh, like, I have not. Oh, well, I know Liz had told me because the VR stuff that y'all can watch movies or whatever.
Yeah.
I was all like, well, we should do like a VR. You know, where we do like a commentary and we're like doing the drinking game.
You know, that's what I was saying. Like, it's like commentary, but it's like a drinking game at the same time. You know, me and the wife tried to play one by ourselves. We did it with, we did it twice. We did it with Dazed and Confused, and we did it with Ghostbusters. And the Ghostbusters, like, nearly fucking killed us, man. We almost got, like, fucking alcohol poisoning. That shit, it's ridiculous. It's all like every time the Ghostbusters theme song plays, take a drink. Every time someone says we got one, you know, take a shot. You know, every time the Marshmallow Man comes out, take two shots or something. I'm like, the fuck, man, you trying to kill it? We didn't even make it halfway through the damn movie. It was that fucking hard. I was like, fuck this. I was like, my liver needs to live for another day. I'm sorry.
Every time Chris tells a story and he references a grade or a year, dude, take a shot. Dude, you'd be like, oh, fuck.
Man, he's all knowledgeable. He's got the dictionary and
he's all like, where was I? Where was I during the, what grade and what year was I in when that happened? That's all.
Well,
I have.
I'm telling you, man, that list I sent you, that link, you should show it to Chris, man. They got the It movie, they got The Shining, they got a drinking game with
I can't wait to actually do, I can't wait to do It. That might be our next one now that we're talking about It. Like, I like to do the random stuff. And for those of you that are, like, obviously listening to this, yeah, we're doing Mortal Kombat. We're, you know, like, I always wanted this to be, like, mainly horror, and it still is, you know. It's, like I said, 95%, but we're going to do, like, more action stuff in the newer movies. So just kind of, you know, just to kind of randomize things, and it makes things a lot funner. Like I said, if we were doing the whole Child's Play series and we're like, we're on Brad of Chucky right now or Cena Chucky, I'd be all pissed off. Like, all right, let's get this over with now, you know. So it's nice to do a newer movie out of nowhere and shit like that and some action stuff.
Freshen
so
it up.
Yeah, I'm enjoying it. So you had asked if I knew the story. I've always kept up with it. Now, I'm not as hardcore as you, I'm assuming, or our good friend Jason, right, Chris? You remember Jason?
Wow, Joey?
Yeah.
I made Kano, Liu Kang, and I'm, you know, since it's April showers, I want to go ahead and do something for Mortal Kombat.
is he still on, like, the first couple of episodes? It's on this podcast, right? The the first Freddy's and shit?
Oh, you still have that on the YouTube videos. I was too. I have them saved on my hard drive. Dude.
Oh, they're not. Oh, but they're not on the Master of the Universe ones, right? They're just like on the original, just like podcast or something, right? Is that what
it
is?
They're on the original YouTube channel. They're there. But
oh my god, that guy Jason, he's a really cool dude. But he was kind of like this guy named, well, you know, Ray a little bit, like where you can't tell him anything, or he like right away gets all like pissed off or whatever. So, or he can't take a joke. So Jason was cool, but he's like a little Ray-ish. But he was totally into fucking Mortal Kombat, man. He's like, buys, like, the thing with Jason was I would always laugh at is he go buy these $100 like figures, like this big old statues of like Motaro. And I've recently pre-ordered, he would always tell you, and then like within 6 months he's like, well, I'm, you know, he would sell it, and then he's like a year later, I'm trying to reobtain, you know.
Re-obtain.
Yeah, and he would just go in this circle. I'm like, Jason, why are you buying these expensive things at full price, reselling it for nothing, and then trying to buy it back again? Like, and I was like, he's like, well, Joey, you know, he'd get all pissed off and pissy.
And then get pissed off at his mom because she wouldn't give him $120 for a fucking Sega Saturn.
Anyway, before we get too caught up in the Jason realm, and I wink at Gabe, yeah, I kind of know. I know that, like, I mean, I played up to 4, right? And then I kind of stopped playing. I played a Deception, Armageddon, and I've kind of kept up with it. I haven't actually played too many of the newer ones, but I like Mortal Kombat so much that I'll just watch, like, a YouTuber go through all the games. And from what I've heard, it's like they have where they have, like, an alternate timeline and all kinds of, you know, shit where, like, Liu Kang dies and all kinds of stuff. But go ahead and tell me, dude. Yeah. You tell me.
Yeah, no, you're pretty spot on. That pretty much, like, how this damn game started, it was, they just gave, like, a good basic view saying Earth is in trouble, you know, other realms, like, other, pretty much, like, other, like, areas, these other realms, like, these other dimensions, they're fighting in a big tournament against each other, and everyone's like, you know, whoever loses will go ahead and will invade the losing planet, or yeah, pretty much that realm. So that was like the basic story, like for the original one, which honestly I didn't even find out till later. But it's basically Earth realm fighting against the Nether realm.
Outrealm.
So The which one?
Outworld.
I think it's called Outrealm.
Outworld.
Oh, is that, Outworld, right?
Yeah, it's Earthrealm, Outworld, the Netherrealm, Adina,
yeah,
Chaos
Netherrealm
Realm,
is like
and
their
Order
hell
Realm.
Or something.
Yeah, but they only really talk from what I know there's six realms, but they always talk about Earthrealm, Outworld, and I think the Netherrealm. Everything else they really don't talk about, Chaos Realm, but yeah, those are the main ones.
As far as the damn games continue, I mean, they're all going at a battle with each other. You know, it's the same thing but you get more of a background story on all these. But yeah, just like how you said, the prophecy or whatever was told that there was going to be a hero, a champion, and that's Liu Kang was the one that's supposed to win it all and save, you know, bring peace to everything. Then later on, you end up finding out that Raiden ends up turning evil, but not on purpose. He ends up turning evil, then they're trying to stop him, then they change things going back and forth, all of a sudden it turns into a whole timeline thing. So by this last one, I think now we're up, I think it's Mortal Kombat 11 now.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden they're, you know, you're fighting your past original characters from part one with the new updated characters that haven't changed at all, you know, and so they're teaming up, fighting against other ones, so... I mean, you started off with only 7 characters from part one. All of a sudden, now you're up to, like, 30 characters, up to, like, these more newer ones. And then alternate costumes, alternate characters, hidden characters, secret codes. Now, as far as that goes, now we're up to the movie. Now, this movie version, though, this movie is doing pretty much the same thing. They're pretty much doing the exact same thing where...
Yeah, yeah.
Earth has got to protect themselves against the Outworld, the evil people.
Yeah.
Evil people, you
the
know,
bad so, dudes, yeah, the bad dudes, yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So, what it didn't really piss me off, but it was kind of irritating, because I enjoyed this movie, I thought it was great. But what's crazy is that as you're watching this movie, and you're seeing everybody go toe-to-toe, you're seeing them, you know, head-to-head, toe-to-toe, you see Bi-Han, which is, he ends up changing his name. He's like, don't call me Bi-Han, I'm Sub-Zero now.
Sub-Zero.
Oh, shit. Sorry. And then it's like Hanzo, which is Scorpion, you know, they're going at it. Yeah, well, not until like near the end. They go at it in the beginning as like their human halves, and then all of a sudden their more mutated, super-powered versions are going at it like towards the end. But anyways, I mean... Everyone's going toe-to-toe, head-to-head. Everyone's losing. They're getting their guts ripped out. Heads are getting, you know, sliced up and all this kind of stuff. And then guess what? Guess what? Seriously. It wasn't even the tournament we were watching. I thought that was the tournament the whole freaking time. I was like, oh, so I guess what they won, and they won without some of the other characters. And then the wife had to go and straighten me out. She's like, you know, that wasn't the tournament. What? What do you mean that wasn't? No, that wasn't the tournament.
Yeah.
I find out that they're setting this up for another part two and a part three. So, I mean, this is basically just a ground base just to go ahead and show you all, like, what's going on.
Yeah.
Like, getting you prepared for markings, prophecies, and all this other stuff. I'm not sure if they're going to do any timeline jumping like they did in the damn video game, but this is actually similar, but yet different. Because in this movie, we're following Cole Young, who's a descendant of Scorpion.
Yeah.
So, unlike, Cole Young's not in any of the games at all. So if you're playing the games and you're looking for that character, I mean, good luck, because he's not in there.
Yeah, that's the thing about this film, is that they actually have a lot of characters, and then they make the main or our main character the person we're supposed to, you know. And I guess that's why they did it. They're like, well, let's get somebody that's not in the game, and have him kind of be put into this world, and him kind of be like, we're supposed to feel like Cole or whatever, as like the person that's not all engulfed in this craziness that's Mortal Kombat. And I understand why they did it, you know. It's like, well, but it's like, you have so many good characters, why wouldn't you use him as the main person or you know, whatever. So I really did like this movie a lot. Of course I have my problems with it, just like everything else, but I always watch a movie, obviously, like everyone else, just to have a good time. and I don't overly like dwell on like, oh, they should have done this, but of course we do a podcast, so yeah, I'm gonna do it today. But I enjoy the fuck out of the film before I say that. But that was one of the problems I had, is that I was like, this guy Cole, he's pretty like worthless for the whole movie. Like I didn't like his acting. I didn't like his acting for the most part. Like my two biggest problems, and we'll get into like all the characters, like you talked about Sonya, and there's so many good people, but I guess, do y'all wanna start off with who we liked or who we didn't like first?
Let's start off with who we liked.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so, you know, I think for a lot of us, the standout was Kano in this motherfucker. I've never been a Kano fan in the games, you know. But damn, he really made the movie a whole lot of fun, dude. What do y'all think about Kano?
Oh, he definitely did. I mean, every movie usually has that one comedic character. I call him the gag character. You know, they go ahead and, regardless of how helpful or useless they are,
I call it the Chris, dude.
They call it the Chris, and they usually go ahead and make they gotta make light of like a serious situation. Like they're the ones that are always making light of, you know, of any kind of dark or, you know, stressing situation. They have to make jokes. They have to go ahead and just lighten the mood, just to make it a little fun. And it gives you a reason to smile, so that way you're not just, like, constantly just staring at the damn TV trying to make sense of it. You gotta have a little bit of laughter, and I think that's the point of that character. He was good, though. He was definitely his sense of humor in that damn movie was pretty damn funny, though.
To me, he carried it. It's like, when you hang out with Chris, you know you're gonna have a good time one way or another. There's gonna be a story to be told by the end of the night with Chris. And, like, with Kano, it's like, again, I wasn't expecting anything from Kano. Like, out of all the characters, I was expecting, you know, like Johnny Cage, Liu Kang, Scorpion, Sub-Zero, Sonya. But it was like, but for Kano to be like a standout, to where when he wasn't there anymore, I was like, well, boo, you know, I'm pretty sure they have to bring him back for the sequel, and I'm sure he's gonna wear the metal plate in his face. You know, there's gonna be some kind of resurrection, because that's just how Mortal Kombat is. Because he was so fascinating in this film with, like, like you said, the humor, that it kind of kept you engaged if it was all action. And I guess, like, in the first one, they had Johnny Cage for that, and I understand that that's probably why they didn't want to put Johnny Cage in this one, but also to kind of string people along for the sequel. But, like, basically, Kano was our Johnny Cage for, like, I know, Chris, you haven't seen the first one, but the way Kano is in this film is like the way Johnny is. But I mean, Kano, I thought, was way funnier than Johnny was in that.
Oh, I've seen enough clips to get the gist of what Johnny Cage is and was supposed to be and everything. So I get that. But at the same time, like, Kano, like exactly like what Gabe said, he's that not really a comic relief guy, because that means he's 100% silly, which he's not. He actually is supposedly has like a special forces mercenary background, blah blah blah. And, I mean, he gets the big pop when he rips the heart out of Reptile. Now, they softened him up to do it, but still, it was a great, great fucking win. Now, he's that prototype, that archetypical character where when there's, like, a serious combat where there's the overarching powerful enemy and there's a few rebel bandits who are trying to fight it, and he's that Harrison Ford in Star Wars. He's fucking Han Solo. He's fucking Wolverine. You know, whatever, you know, and that's the thing. Now, like I said, I never cared for the character. I didn't give him a second thought when we were kids playing the game, but the way they position him in this movie is a very good positioning. Now, is he good? Yes. Is there always going to be somebody better than him, especially when you're talking about decades past? Yes. Me and my wife were watching it last night, And she kind of thought he was like kind of like a wannabe Hugh Jackman as Wolverine.
He's like, she's like, me and my wife, and then he winks at Rose.
kind of like charism actors that we had decades past, generations past. Like,
oh,
you know, like
I'm glad you brought that up. Yeah, yeah, go ahead. I like where you're going with this.
Like okay, like you take a guy like Stallone, and he's playing Rocky, and then I'm talking about the first two Rockies. And you try to pass Michael B. Jordan isn't a bad actor, but like he doesn't have the kind of naturally occurring charisma to play off like the second coming of Rocky in Creed. Or like you take Han Solo, like Harrison Ford being Han Solo. Fucking all these things, like you know, you can go on and on and on in different examples, but the point I'm trying to make is like the you had to be the best of the best, the top of the top to be in these roles back in the day. And now it's like anyone who understands what the character is going to go out there and play them. And I'm not saying this guy that played Kano did a bad job, but he does. In my opinion, he doesn't live up to what we had as kids.
Well, I like this character. I thought it was kind of like, I mean, I liked what they did with him. I know it's ridiculous for people, but I like the guy that played Kano in the original film. He wasn't really Australian, you know. And I loved his Kano and like his lines. They were like really memorable. And he wasn't given anywhere near the amount of stuff to work with that this guy does. But I would always laugh. He's all like, "Do you miss me, baby?" He would like, all, you know, like, right? He's all like,
yeah.
"Oh, I studied all your moves." And like this, like, "I cut your partner from ear to ear. You know, and like he's just like over the top. Where he's kind of funny and like, you know, he has the charisma. I liked him a lot. This one, it was like a Deadpool Kano, which I was fine with. He made the movie more enjoyable. But yeah, I understand what you're saying. Like for me, I know, again, I have to bring it up. I want Gabe's opinion. We're gonna go through the characters basically, and we'll go through the parts and shit that way. But like for Raiden, like I really didn't like Raiden in this film compared to the other guys because the part one Raiden, what's that guy's name? Gabe, you know his name? He's like, he played Highlander. I forget his name. He's like, I loved him. He was like, you know, I know he's not, you know, like a Japanese or Chinese, whatever he's supposed to be what Raiden's supposed to be in the film. I think Japanese, but, like the way Christopher Lambert. Yeah. He played in Highlander and a bunch of shit. Like, I love the charisma. You were talking about charisma. And then in part two, like, I hate his voice, but like, it's the guy that comes out in the Warriors. I should have all this in front of me, but James Remar, or Remar, whatever. Like him too. Like the charisma that they give off as Raiden is so much better than this guy's. Like I kind of like saw Raiden. I didn't feel like, oh yeah, we should be listening to his wisdom. Like I didn't feel like that with this guy. I mean, I don't know how y'all felt, but
no. Honestly, you're spot on because I was gonna make a point of that too. If you noticed, like. The original one had more of a pleasant, more attitude, and he was more concerning. Like, he would tell him, in the original 1995 version, he was telling him, like, about a certain issue. Like, we have to protect Earthrealm. You are the warriors. But he had, like that kind of sly voice. Like, he's already been talking for a while. Like, his voice is already getting a little low. This newer one, he was just kind of... He came off kind of a dick.
Yeah.
He was just like straightforward. You're not that good. You don't have the potential. We need to find somebody else. And I was like, that's it? And you're Raiden. You got to be like, you're protecting Earth wrong. You're just going to be straight out dick. I understand, you know, Earth is in peril, but I mean, come on, man. You're not like the Christopher Lambert from the...
Yeah, and even James Remar, like in part two, like I didn't like him because his voice is really good. He has like that raspier, very, very, it stands out, James Remar's voice. But I'm like, well, even him was like, I thought was a way better Raiden than this guy. If they would have had either of those come back to play, like, you know, Christopher Lambert coming back in this role, I know he's not, you know, the ethnicity that he's supposed to be. But the charisma, you have to find someone that has that charisma just like, you know, him. I don't know, Chris, did you really feel like Raiden was someone you're like, oh, like, I know you were like, he's just teleporting, you know? And like, I didn't feel like he had any good speeches or like, once you see the other ones, you're going to know what I'm talking about. But I mean, just from what you saw.
Just from what I saw and having not really seen him in those clips of the other one, I can't. I agree. Didn't have the greatest speeches in the world, but I just think with the Raiden and this movie, it's his presence and the way the film presents him is just, to me, was magnificent.
You liked it because, yeah, you don't have the backstory, but I love the way he actually was, like, morphing around and all the thunder. I thought that was cool as shit, but when he was talking, it was kind of like, okay, you know.
You know who he came off of when he talked? He kind of reminded me of Sato in Karate Kid 2.
You, Miyagi. Miyagi, you come in Mortal Kombat Tournament. You beat Shang Tsung.
I give you 3 days to mourn, then you leave my temple.
Yeah, I didn't really care for him. Speaking of, like the main guys, I think it's a detriment that you haven't seen the first two Mortal Kombats that could really make this comparison. But Shang Tsung, this guy, I think he did a good job. But that original Shang Tsung is just, I mean, he
was more intense.
Yeah, yeah.
The old one was.
Yeah, he was just, especially his face, his facials, no homo, right?
Oh, definitely. You know, it's like him going like, just your soul is mine. Like, in the beginning when he's like, he's all, no, what was his, Liu Kang's brother?
Yeah.
He's all sucking his soul out, and he was like so intense in that moment. Yeah. I was like, oh, Jesus. I was like, man, that is that's a damn good,
intro,
good,
right?
Expression there. Yeah, yeah, that was a damn good intro.
It's and funny.
When he wakes up, it was a nightmare, you know? Mm-hmm.
But I do know what you're saying, because I saw Shang Tsung in the clips of the 95 one,
yeah,
and I saw him here, and I think in this one, like y'all were saying, in this one, he's just this smug, cocky,
yeah,
whatever, I'm better than you kind of guy. But in that one, yes, he is a lot more intense, a lot more vibe energy. But that also goes with that one, that 95 one, it's high energy anyway. That one comes in hot, it comes in energized. It's just raw energy. And here, this one is more like a slow origin story.
Oh, if they said high energy, I was going to play the Owen Hart song, dude.
Pull up my suspender pants.
Yeah.
You're definitely right as far as it being a slow startup. Because, like I said, I was expecting this whole thing to be, like, I thought this was the tournament. I thought we were already getting into it because, like, I was making too much of a comparison to the 95. And, no, I mean, this, you're right, this whole thing was just a build-up, so part two is the tournament. Mm-hmm. Apparently they're going to be working on that already, and, you know, we'll actually get to, maybe we'll get more intensity in the second one.
This will bring armies next time.
At the end.
Oh,
combat, yeah, they, outside the tournament is not illegal.
Yeah, he's, next time,
and then they, yeah, he's all like, what do you say? He's all like, they all his army or his little group ended up dying. They all got whooped. All their asses got whooped or killed. And he's all, oh, death isn't the end. It's just another dimension or another realm.
Yeah, yeah. He says,
and so they all end up disappearing. And I'm like, oh, okay. That, there you go. Now they're going to come back and they're going to fight in the tournament for part two.
Yeah, like, that's what I was talking about with Kano. And I know you were saying, like, you didn't know they were having this wasn't the tournament. They say it, like, in the middle of the film. I forgot exactly the words or the verbiage, but they're like, we didn't win 9 tournaments by playing by the rules. And, like, they were like, oh, like, basically, they gave off that they were going to hunt down everyone before they even had a chance to get to the tournament. I forgot where I was just like, oh, they're killing everyone before there's even a tournament. That's why, you know, Sub-Zero was being sent off to go kill everyone by, because no, like, and Cole's, it's funny because Cole, like, I thought, like, when I was saying about earlier how Cole's like we don't really like mesh with him well, because it's just like he's a bad actor and everything else, but like the stupid shit that he does, like, you know, just speaking on him, like at the very end of the, like, well, towards the very end, he's all like he, all of a sudden he's like the leader, he's like, okay, to, you know, to beat Sub-Zero, we're going to have to do it together. And they're like, oh, okay, well, how are we going to do that? You know, they're like, and then he starts telling, oh, well, you're going to fight this guy, and then you're going to fight that guy, and then we're all going to go together. And then when they finally do, you know, beat all the guys they're supposed to beat, that jackass runs in to go fight Sub-Zero by himself because he sees, like his daughter's bracelet. I'm like, you fucking idiot. You're going to go, you're like, you know, you should know it's a trap. I mean, come on now.
Oh, a lot of these heroes, regardless, even if they know it's a trap, they feel like the need that they have to go and do it, regardless of how bad whatever situation is. They jump in head first and kind of cross their fingers and hope for the best that nothing bad happens to them.
Yeah, but the Shang Tsung, I thought he was cool. I would laugh every time he would come on film because he would do this walk and like his hair would just look funny and he looked like he had a dress kind of thing on. So every time he would come out on there, it was supposed to be like this powerful thing, and I would just laugh because the original one, he just had like a leather jacket, you know, some kind of long leather jacket. It just looked badass, and you know, he's just there yelling the whole time. But
I kid you not, though, just to mention, Kung Lao was the shit in this damn movie, man.
Mm-hmm. Fuck yeah.
Mm-hmm. He was fucking cool as shit, throwing his hat on the damn floor, just like in the damn video game, and then runs one of the characters right. His hat gets stuck into the floor and then starts spinning. Grabs one of the characters, and just like a little grinder, you know, just ends up running the characters right through it. Just chopping them all, splitting them all in half.
We saw where he cuts the chicken half, yep.
That was amazing. I was like, I honestly applauded for that one. I liked that.
Yeah, Nidorah, yeah. the flying half chick bat, whatever the fuck she was. Nidorah, whatever her name is.
Yeah, the Dragon Wing Broad.
Dragon Wing Broad it is.
Yeah, I was like, you know what, good riddance to that character. That character didn't do shit. You know, it was just cool just to see that damn fucking hat chop that chicken half. I was like, okay. Shit, that was cool.
Okay, and here's the thing, too. Here's the thing with Kung Lao. What also was
Kung
excellent
Lao.
About
him. I'm going to say it every time y'all say his name.
Kung Lao.
Kung Lao.
He got Shang Tsung over because he throws that devastating hat that's been beating everyone he throws it at, and Kung Lao just moves his head a couple inches and ducks it.
Yeah, that was like, I mean, exactly what you said, Gabe. Like, yeah, Kung Lao was the shit in this film, dude. Like, I was telling my brother, you know, talking about the film, like saying, like, I really enjoyed it. Like, I have fun with these films. Like, Godzilla, I had a shit ton of fun. We'll do that eventually. Like, this one's a shit ton of fun, but, like, there's little parts I was like, that I have problems with. And one of them was like, man, I like Kung Lao so much more than Liu Kang in this film. Like, you know, he really felt like a leader. He felt like the one that, like, yeah, now you know why Liu was following him. I guess that was the point. But it felt like he had so much more charisma than Raiden and then all the other warriors. You know what I mean? Like, so I wish he would have had a little bit more time. But every time he was on the screen, I was like, dude, what's Kung Lao? Whose ass is Kung Lao going to kick? And who's going to get sliced down that shit?
Yeah, I agree. He seems to be the best fighter, you know, early on in the movie. But at the same time, this movie as a whole gave me a more appreciation. Like, I never cared for Liu Kang when I was, you know, was a kid playing the games or anything like that. But now I see, like, you know, he's a leader among men. He's the cousin of Kung Lao. He's got the fire in his hands. He's the antithesis to Sub-Zero. Like, and I appreciate that so much more now, having seen this movie.
Well, I kid you not, though, as far as, like, video game tournaments go, Kung Lao is actually one of the top-tier characters that is a... He's broken in there. Like, everyone chooses a Kung Lao. That's, like, their top guy to play with, you know, when whooping ass. So, to see him in the damn movie, you know, whooping ass, it only goes with it even further. Just, he's that much of a badass. And I was like, oh, shit, he's fucking cool. Too bad we didn't see. In the damn game, he goes ahead and teleports, you know, and just the way he comes up from up and down from the ground, it's pretty neat. Yep. But sadly, we didn't get to see no teleporting with him in this. But it was still awesome just to see that damn hat move. You know, and as much as
I wasn't expecting that at all, dude. I was like, wow, that was really cool.
You know, just to see Kung Lao pick a fight with Kano, did you all happen to enjoy that dinner fight about the egg roll?
Pass me my fucking egg roll! And then, yeah, he finds his power. I thought that was...
Arcana.
Arcana, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So basically, it's kind of like the X-Men, where like they have to get so enraged or have some kind of traumatic, you know, thing happen. Yeah, and they get their power. And I knew I'd get mine first, you know. And I love that whole like little. I thought it was kind of like funny, like and ridiculous that like this guy who's like what is he in the Black Dragon? Is his gang or whatever with Cabal, who we meet in a little bit, or we'll talk about a little bit. Like, you know, he's been angry before. He must have been really pissed off if that you know, scenario is the one that gave him his fucking powers and shit. You know what I mean? I thought that was kind of dumb. I'm like, isn't he like a mercenary and he's always like worked up and like that? He wanted an egg roll and now he's shooting a fucking laser beam out of his eye, you know?
Yeah, but I mean, he even said it too. He's all like, I am wanted in like so many countries. I am the leader of the Black Dragon, this and this. So yeah, he's a badass for a reason. So
don't get me started on that.
Why? For what? The Black Dragon?
Black Dragon, you know who I'm going at. Okay, there ain't no history to it other than, like, if you want to 1980s, maybe. But, you know, fucking...
the movie, The Black Dragon, or what?
Certain movie made in early 1988 starring Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Was it called Black Dragon, or what?
No, I mean, Jean-Claude had a Universal Soldier, and he also had Cyborg.
Bloodsport.
Remember,
most people's knowledge of Frank Dukes stops at the movie Bloodsport and what the
wait a minute, let me stop you. So is Frank Dukes and the Black Dragon have something to do with each other? Because that's where, I don't know if you know this, and then I wink at Gabe, but Mortal Kombat came from that Jean-Claude Van Damme movie Bloodsport. But go ahead.
Yeah, well, Frank Dukes claims to have been a member of the Black Dragon Society.
What the fuck is that?
Wait. Frank Dukes, is that the motorcycle guy? His buddy in that movie?
No. That's Jackson.
That's Jean-Claude. Jean-Claude Van Damme is named Dukes. You know, that's supposed to be, and that's supposed to be based off of.
It's been a while since I've seen that movie.
Yeah, it's supposed to be based off of a true story from that guy Frank Dukes. But tell us the story, Chris, real quick.
So Frank Dukes today is about 65 years old, and he's, you know, has always had dojos. Like, now he claimed, and he's written a book, a couple books, and he's been on all these fucking martial arts videos, stuff like that. Claims to have been a member of this ninja order called the Black Dragon Society. And I mean, now here's the thing: the movie is fucking great. Don't get me wrong, I love Bloodsport. I'll watch it any day of the week, any place it starts off, picks up. But the guy's claims are so questionable.
Is his name Ray?
He had a friend named Ray.
So I didn't know all that, but yeah, they had came up with the idea for Mortal Kombat. For those of you that don't know, we didn't mention it, but it's pretty much well known knowledge now and all that shit. But anyway, let's go ahead and get it to Sonya Blade, dude. The old heartbreaker, the old heartbreaker for Gabe, dude. Like, go ahead, dude. Like, you got
right here.
You got something to say?
That's a pretty girl right there. I mean, she was keeping me interested the whole time. Yeah, she fights good and all, but I mean, goddamn, girl. I was like, you know what you're doing. It's funny, though, because she, I don't know how you all felt about this. She didn't have the damn dragon mark. So, and I was thinking, like, how the hell is she going to get involved in this? But then they ended up saying anybody with the birthmark of that dragon is basically a defender of Earthrealm. They're going to be entered in that tournament. Well, she didn't have one, but then she ended up mentioning, while she was giving some background on Kano, she ended up saying the birthmark, or that dragon birthmark, can transfer from one person to another.
Yes.
Anyways, later on, she ends up getting into a badass fight, and she ends up getting that dragon tattoo on her. But it was funny, though, because, and I thought this was the most interesting part, because I was like, man, damn, girl doesn't have any powers like the damn, like the damn video game. But I was like, nah, it's cool. She's still a badass. The original one, she didn't have any powers anyways. But she did have that good leg grappling move. So I was like, oh, that's pretty nice. Well,
the legs or the move?
she grabs with her legs.
Yeah, so with Kano. Yeah, yeah. Flips them. I'm just giving you a hard time, dog.
I know. Well, on this newer one, she finally got her damn rings. She came in at the last minute, fucking blasted a damn hole in that.
Melina, from the original game. Yeah, in the original game, she would throw those like circle rings. So yeah, when she kills Kano by giving him the old Karam jab to the eye with the fucking gnome gimmick on the yard, and then takes his power, and then she's got that ring thing and kills Melina. She wasn't in the film too much. I like the way she looked with her mouth gimmick, I thought that was pretty cool, but
like the Joker,
but I didn't think her character was anything like this that stood out or whatever. Kind of like just felt like thrown in. Well, I liked a little bit more. Like, if you're going to throw a character in there like that and you just have, she's supposed to be the twin sister of Katana, which is the blue ninja that Chris was talking about earlier. I was like, well, I really don't want to see that character again if they're twin sisters. Like, I'd like to see somebody. Like, I love the original Katana, dude. She was over like a son bitch, and then I wink at Gabe. But, that was that part. Another character that was kind of thrown in was the guy with the hammer. Were you familiar with him? His name's like Renko or something, or Reiko. I had no idea who he was, but I guess that's because they knew they were just gonna kill him off and shit. But they had him and Cabal.
Oh, that Thanos looking guy?
Yeah, with the hammer gimmick.
Yeah, I don't remember that guy at all.
Yeah, it was kind of like.
I mean, honestly, he doesn't look like a memorable character either. If anything, I don't remember him in the games.
I've seen him, but it was just briefly. But it was just like whatever. But yeah, he got his ass kicked by Jax, and this Jax was pretty good. I like my favorite Jax was from Part 2 because he's so over the top. He's all like, man, I wish I had these in high school, kid. He does that Ray, the arms and shit.
Yeah. Man, that was pretty badass. I thought it was pretty impressive because he lost his arms, so he's sitting on the damn bed, and they got these monks that are trying to work on him. I'm like, what the hell are they gonna do? I was like, these monks, out of nowhere. Well, funny enough, after a while, they give him like robotic arms, and they start moving him around. I was like, man, those are some high tech damn monks.
I know.
Living in a damn cave, and that they're able to whip up some mechanical ship or mobile arms for him. It's like, man, that's impressive. I was like, good for them.
Yeah, I'm
not just sitting in a cave somewhere.
I knew it was coming because it's like, well, it's Jax. You know he's going to get it, but it's like, they're monks in a cave. Like you're saying, like, how the fuck are they going to pull some shit out of their fucking hats, with these cyborg arms? And, I like that he was kind of like the bridge of characters for everyone. He shows us Cole and Sonya and all that, but yeah, Sonya was really good in this film. I liked her. Like, she might be my favorite version of Sonya, to be honest. Like, the first Sonya, she's very memorable because she came out in, like, a bunch of film, Billy Madison and shit. And she's, like, she's good, but I didn't believe her fighting, when she was fighting. She looked like she was a tough girl, and she had good acting, but that was it. The second Sonya, I thought she was really pretty, that chick. But she didn't look like a tough enough girl to actually whoop the ass, This one looked like she was, she was a pretty woman. She was tough enough and all that shit. And, she was a good actor. So, yeah, she's probably, my favorite Sonya, which is kind of crazy knowing that we had two really good Sonyas, prior to this. But I don't know. Do you have a Sonya ranking for us, dude?
Oh, me? Yeah, you're right. I mean, this Sonya was better. I mean, looking at the fight scene between her and Kano when they were already starting to threaten each other. So she just kind of whooped his ass. She was, like, jumping around and flipping. Yeah, well, I mean, not so much as back flipping, but, I mean, just kind of grappling, doing some, like, UFC type of shit. So I was like, man, damn girl, it looks good. She can fight. She had the damn knife at his throat. So, man, I don't know. She's definitely, like, at least a good, like, 8.
Yeah.
A good 8 or 9. I have to give it 8 or 9 because in case I'm more impressed with part 2 and then Katana comes out and, you know, all of a sudden she's more hotter and more mobile than this girl, then she's going to be ranked number 2. But yeah. In the meantime, Sonya's winning right now.
One of my highlights on this film, it was like a highlight and a low light. Am I saying that right? But it was Goro, dude, you know. Prince Goro.
Goro from part 1, the original, was way better. He came out, they gave him a good entrance. You know, it was just yeah, and then you had all the damn guards or the other like normal people, I guess.
The normies
were cheering him on.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were all cheering him on, and Goro's like, yeah, and he's getting ready to fight Johnny Cage. This one, he was already, he just kind of came out and just started kind of, he was just like all mad. He just didn't seem as menacing as the, you know, as the older one, though.
Yeah, well, my whole thing was this one is like, I love the way Goro looked. Like, he's over there, like, snarling through his nose. And, like, he looked like a, like, I was like, you know, obviously he's CGI, but I enjoyed the way he looked. And then that was it. Everything else, like the fight with Cole, I was kind of like, this is like a stupid fight because, like, I'm like, you know, because Cole, he gets his powers, right? And it's like he has, like, armor on his upper body, and, like, that's it. And I'm like, why doesn't Goro just kick him in the legs? You know what I mean? Like, what the fuck? You know, just grab him by the leg. Like, he can't, like, that's his powers, that he's a shitty fighter, but he could take an ass whooping, like, oh, whip-de-doo, Rocky Jr. All right, great. You know, doing that old Chris routine.
I mean, this guy, like, he's not even a Stallone, not even on Stallone's worst day, and this guy on his best day isn't even close to that.
Yeah, it's like, well, they have Goro. I love the way Goro was, like, snarling and all that. Like, it was very intimidating. But, yeah, like what Gabe was saying, the Goro, the first one, like, he talks and everything, and he's a, like, you know, like, I love the way he's, like, you know, like, he, like, just grabs Johnny Cage's glasses and breaks them and everything. It's just, like, Goro's way better in this one, in the first one. This one, the way he looked was better. Everything else was, like, it was shitty. Like, it pissed me off that Cole had weapons and stabs Goro in the eye and stabs him in the guts and he rips off, like, he breaks it. Like, what the fuck? It's Goro. Like, at least get him over before you just make him look like some putty.
You know, actually, what I was really kind of... It sounds kind of cruel, but I was kind of rooting for, because I was like, he came out, and you, like we were talking about earlier, we knew what was going to happen. You knew it was going to be some kind of trap. You know, Cole Young ends up coming home because he needs to protect his damn family. And, you know, here comes Goro. He's like fucking shit up. And honestly, I was kind of rooting for that he would go after, because he didn't even get his powers yet. Cole Young didn't get his powers. And I was thinking, like, oh, I know what's going to happen. He's going to kill his damn family off. Goro's going to kill off his family, or somebody's going to do something, and then that's going to trigger his powers. Well,
that would have been good. It would have been good if Goro just killed them all, and then there was no Cole Young. I mean, I thought that and get all the other characters more, like, you know, pumped up and keep Kung Lao. Because to me, I mean, Cole was kind of like a useless character. I didn't really. I mean,
he was, but like you said earlier, he's our eyes, like, to this whole Mortal Kombat world. He's the one getting the explanations. He's getting the view of, you know, this is all new to him, just like us. Like, when we're watching it, we're trying to be new to this whole thing, like, we're not understanding it.
He's the protagonist, and also too, like, I gotta say, like, I pop because it's in the mold of so many things you see, and you're waiting for this protagonist who you know is supposed to be somebody special, but it's just not happening for him for the body of the movie. And then finally, you know, after having been sent back to Earthrealm by Raiden, you know, he's back with his family, and now here's Goro fucking with his family. Right. And now, in the midst of getting his ass whipped, he finds this inner strength and starts to develop his arcana. And I pop even when fucking Raiden tells Shang Tsung, thank you for helping my fighter find his arcana.
Yeah, he does tell him that. He tells him all that bullshit. Yeah, I mean, it was like I said, it was a high and low for me. I love the way he looked. But it was like they should have gave him a voice. He should have been like – it just feels like we felt – I felt cheated that was all – that was the only Goro that we got. But, I mean, hopefully – I don't know how
he's going to come back. I was kind of thinking that, you know, since he died and got gutted, remember that Goro was the main – he was like the badass that we all had to fight in Mortal Kombat 1.
Yeah.
Remember part 2, we had Kintaro.
Yeah.
And then part 3, we had Montoro. And I was like, oh, you know what? I'd love. See, Mortal Kombat Annihilation brought out Montoro, the damn half horse, half. Well, damn Minotaur. Or, yeah.
Yeah, Minotaur. Centaur? Yeah, Centaur. Yeah, it's exactly.
Centaur. There you go. It's like a Centaur kind of thing. So, you know, I'm kind of hoping, you know, just leave Goro dead. I mean, he didn't really do much for me anyways. But go ahead and bring in, like, some of these other bigger badass characters, you know.
Yeah, I agree with that. Nice. Yeah, let Kintaro, like, be a highlight, because it is technically Mortal Kombat 2. So let's just pretend, like, you know, this is part 2, and, you know, Shang Tsung's actually going to be in the tournament, like, the way he is in the video game in part 2. And, you know, mm-hmm. you know, like, and all that shit. Because, yeah, that would be good. It'd be nice to, you know, like, okay. But it was like... They call him the Shokin Prince and all this, whatever the fuck. It's like he just died like that. He was in the film for like less than 5 minutes, you know. So yeah. I kind of it was like I said. I liked the way he looked, but it was also very disappointing. Kane, dude. Liu Kane and Cabal's fight, but Liu Kane in general. Before I get into Liu Kane, I love Cabal's, you know, line in the film. He's like, do you know a guy down there goes by the name of Kano? You know, and he's like, because they're asking about if you know, who can help out. And he goes, he's a low-life scumbag piece of shit. You're going to love him. And like... That's like something that Mark has always like. Those are like the words that Mark says all like for years. Hey, what are y'all pieces of shit doing? Oh, you're eating like a scumbag and all that shit.
Yeah, but, you're drinking beer like a scumbag.
Yeah, piece of shit. Low. That's some low life. So when I swear, dude, I looked at Chris. Rose is there. I was all like, oh my god, is that Mark? Like, he's called, like, both of us, you know, like, oh, y'all low-life scumbags, you know, like, but the way he said it, you're gonna love him.
and that fucking Brooklyn maid guy, he's a low-life piece of shit scumbag.
Yeah, I started laughing at it, because it was like, Kano had his accent, and it's like, was everyone have accents that are, like, in the Black Dragon bullshit, you know? You're gonna love him. I thought it was cool, but I actually really liked Cabal's and Liu Kang's fight. Like, I didn't like Liu Kang at all, really, in this film, till he had that fight with Cabal and him trying to save, you know, Kung Lao. Like, they're fighting, right? He's all like, oh, he's about to get his soul sucked. That's my favorite part, or whatever. Like, the sound they make is my favorite part. And like, he says that, like, Liu does something. He tries to save him, and then he sees that. And that part was really cool with Shang Tsung when he's like ripping that green soul out of Kung Lao and he's like, oh, doing all that bullshit. I was like, wow, do you feel like that was one of the few times in this film where I felt like real emotion, like, no, not Kung Lao. Someone save him. Someone save Kung Lao. You know, that kind of deal. So how did y'all feel about that whole bullshit?
The same. Like, you don't want to see fucking like such a strong.
He's episode. Like, actually, I was thinking about a belt buster, but I mean, Kung Lao was pretty good.
Oh, like our friend Jason that we just brought up earlier. Where would he get a belt buster?
Where would he get a belt?
but no, I hated seeing that. Fuck, Kung Lao's fucking badass, and he's like the one badassery on the Earth Realm side that you have, and he gets fucking killed. It's like when Optimus Prime dies in the 1986 Transformers. I mean, fuck.
Well, I've never seen that, but thanks for spoiling it, Chris. That old Jay routine, he loves it. He swims in the spoiler. You have to like spoiler alert any other movies or Chris right away. I'm just fucking with you, Chris. But we have fun here. But Dude, how did you feel? Well, I liked, like, that whole scene. Like I said, I really didn't feel like Liu Kang was doing what he needed to do or didn't feel like a leader. I guess that's probably where part two is going, is that this is what makes him a leader, I guess, you know? So he's fighting, like, Cabal, and he gets up getting thrown into, like, that pool of oil or whatever it is. And then he does that, like, where he's got the fire gimmicks coming out of his hand. No Harry Potter shit. And he, like, has the dragon come out and kill Cabal. I thought that was, like, really badass. I was like, I love how they're doing, like, oh, he goes, he even says it, fatality for Kung Lao, you know?
Oh, they all do reference like that. It's like, Kano wins, fatality, Kung Lao. They all do shit like that.
What a beauty.
Yeah, Liu Kang just wasn't, I don't know, I just wasn't cheering for him. I didn't really... He wasn't pulling me in. He was just more the explanation of, you know, why certain people or whatever they're doing there, why they're doing there. He was like the, you know, just that cheap kind of, not cheap, but like a good explanation of just why certain things are the way they are. And he just didn't. I mean, he started off a fight with Sub-Zero. He threw a damn fireball at him. So I was like, oh, shit, yeah, okay, now he's going to start doing some shit. And then all of a sudden, Sub-Zero throws, like, an ice ball at him, and then he gets hit. And I was like, oh, man, that wasn't a, you know, I mean, do what he did with your fireball, you know, dodge that shit.
It would have done a lot to get the Liu Kang character over if just one fireball had neutralized Sub-Zero's ice.
Yeah.
Exactly. Like, I would like to see some of that shit. You know, he throws a damn fireball and they throw an ice ball at the same time and just kind of see them both, you know, fizzle or I don't know. I just didn't feel much for this character.
They didn't put him over enough, right? You just kind of felt like he was there. Like if you didn't actually, like if you just watched this movie, right, and you had no background with the video games and you're just watching it, you would have no idea that Liu Kang's supposed to be some hero or anything, right? You would just be like, yeah, that one guy.
Exactly. I didn't see him yelling out saying, we got to do this for the world. Like, he didn't seem that enthusiastic. Like you said, it seemed like he was following Kung Lao because, you know, that they're brothers and they're just...
We were supposed to die together, and he said all that shit.
Yeah, and so it just kind of like, didn't really go much anywhere else for me on that. Yeah. So I was just like, you know what? Fuck that guy. I was like, Liu Kang sucks in this one.
He sucked in this one regardless, but it sucks too that the Liu Kang in the first two films is so much better. You know, he really makes like a difference than like, you're like, what the fuck? You know, this guy didn't do shit in this
one. Funny enough, you know, I thought Liu Kang was pretty badass in the original one, and so I was like, oh yeah, he's pretty cool. But then once I started hearing my sister talking about, like, man, he's so hot, oh man, he's so great, I'm like, you know what, I don't think I like Liu Kang anymore. you're getting weird on me on that, and that's not good.
What about toward the end, when he does the levitating bicycle kick? I mean, that made Liu Kang look good toward the end.
Oh, it did.
Yeah, it's all saying, like, the whole... If it wasn't for that fight, I wouldn't have said anything positive about Liu Kang, you know?
Yeah, honestly. Between him and Cabal, I mean, that was probably, like, the only decent thing they really had going on with each other. You know, I mean, that's about it, really. There wasn't really much going on.
Yeah.
Remember the bicycle kick, though, from the 95 version?
Oh, it was great. With reptiles.
When he was fighting a damn reptile. Oh, shit. That was, like, the best fucking scene out of that whole damn movie. Was just them going at it and the music.
Yeah, oh, yeah, exactly. I always say, what's the best fight to that movie? Like, for me, it's the reptile and Liu Kang, dude. Number one, it's, like, that's the best one. And then for me, number two, it's probably, like, Johnny Cage versus Scorpion. And, you know, like, those are, like, really good fights. Like, they actually go at it in those, like, you know, it felt like a video game watching those fights, you know?
Yeah, it was. It was really great. It was just awesome watching that shit. And Liu Kang was just, like, pumped. Remember when Reptile all dizzied up, and he's all like, and he starts like buffing up, man. He started charging up, getting ready to go in and attack his ass. Dude, this Liu Kang didn't do that shit. He was just like, all right, I'm gonna go punch him or go do something now. Maybe bring out a fire dragon, you know, bring out some Harry Potter shit, you know. You know, what the hell?
No Harry Potter like, shit.
Yeah, I wasn't impressed with that. I don't know, the old... I don't know, maybe I have just more nostalgia for the older one.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. That's exactly. The nostalgia, the nostalgia from the original makes you like see, like, man, these guys should be doing better jobs, you know, with these castings, really, or story also, too. Acting, everything.
But even visually, the Liu Kang from the 95 one, he looks like a guy that's like a notch down from Bolo Yang. And this guy is just like a long-haired, ripped Asian guy.
So you're saying you'd sleep with him, dude?
Yeah.
At least get dinner.
I always laugh when Rose laughs. It makes it even funnier. then I know I did a good job, you know, fucking making it everywhere. then it's like someone hearing this podcast is gonna laugh at that one. So good job, Rose. You're keeping us strong here.
But you can agree, like the 95 Liu Kang looks like a notch down.
He's like, Joe, are you saying you wouldn't sleep with him? And then he's winking at Rose. He's trying to be the funny guy now. What are you, nuts? Have you seen the abs on that guy? No, the Liu Kang. I mean, he looked like a kid. And this guy in this film, he looked like a little kid to me.
Yeah.
And Liu Kang in the other one, it's like... I wouldn't want to fight, you know, Robin So, I think his name is, in the first one. And, like, you could tell he's, you know, he's pumped and, you know, and Chris wants to sleep with him. I mean, it's very simple things to follow. No, but yeah, the first guy, he's great. I mean, he's badass. Like, they look like men, like intimidating dudes. And this one, they don't really give off of that, you know. Chris, yeah. Like, it's intimidating.
Now, if we're going to talk about intimidating characters, oh, shit, man. I kid you not, that damn Sub-Zero and that Scorpion, man, they look badass. I felt like, especially damn Sub-Zero, those damn eyes, oh man, he had like some intense facial, you know, shit going on. I mean, human, like in the beginning, like the way he looked was, you know, he looked like some average Joe. He was like a badass fighter.
His name is Joe. His name is Joe too. I think Joe Psalm or something like that.
Yeah, it is actually Joe Taslim.
Yeah, Taslim or Psalm, however they say it.
Yeah, Taslim. Yeah. That's his name. But he looked like your average Joe, but he fights like a fucking badass. I was like, oh man, I think I seen someone like him, like that in downtown area, you know, just walking about. And I was like, shit, look at that behind, man. He's all badass.
Yeah, you had mentioned, I'm glad you brought up Scorpion and Sub-Zero, because that's exactly how I was going to end the podcast, kind of getting to the main event, because the whole film, like, I think the best part of this film, I said Kano, like, was a standout, but, I mean, if they would have just made the film about Scorpion and Sub-Zero, you know, I would have been fine with it, because those are definitely the best parts, and I loved everything about it, but I knew a lot of the story. Like you were saying, when you would go to the arcades, they would show you dun 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 dun, and they had like the screen moving them like doing some kind of pose and whatever. And you would say like Johnny Cage is a movie star going here to prove it, and like Scorpion and Sub-Zero. Like I had beat the game as a kid with every single character because I wanted to see like the story of everything. And then I remember seeing when you win with Sub-Zero, like he's just doing like when you know that victory pose that he does. It's like you know the Lin Kuei clan, you know of Bihan, you know. There's thousands of Sub-Zeros. They took over, and then I remember them talking about Scorpion. Like he finally avenged, killed Sub-Zero the tournament for avenging his family, something like that. And then so I knew a lot of the lore already. I didn't remember it verbatim, but I had an idea. So when this film, when I saw the intro with Scorpion, we all knew who was Scorpion. And I have to say, like the best characters, actors, everything is the guy that plays, you know, Scorpion and Sub-Zero. Those guys are just are unbelievable, dude. That the guy that plays Scorpion, yeah.
I pop for the fact that Sub-Zero is the guy from fucking
Warrior. Have you seen Warrior, Gabe?
Warrior?
It's a TV series. I guess not, because if you don't know.
No.
It's on HBO Max, dude, in the Warrior series. So, luckily, I had just finished watching all of the Warrior series, and it's based off Bruce Lee's script ideas from back in the day. And that guy Joe's in the, you know, Sub-Zero, he's in that show, and he's great in there. He does, like, it's funny because all the how he smiles, how he walks with his hands behind his back, he does all that there. So it was really cool to see him, you know, like, hey, that's a good gimmick to go with. Let me add that with Sub-Zero when he's human, because, you know, when he walks in and he's like asking for what's his name, Scorpion, whatever his Japanese
Hanzo,
yeah. He's a Hanzo, you know, all that stuff. And the wife's like, he's not here, you know. And he's like smiling. He's got his hands behind his back, like that sinister kind of, you know, gimmick. He's great without the mask, you know. And then he puts his mask on, like you were saying, and he like still gives off that intimidate. Like he's able to give the expressions just with his eyes very well. And then that whole fight at the end where he's selling for Scorpion and Cole. When his like takes off his mask, like that dude was just unbelievable. But then also Hiroyuki, the guy that plays Scorpion, he comes out in The Last Samurai. Like that guy's like 50 or 60 years old, dude. I'm like,
yeah,
that guy. And, you know, Chris was squirting for Robin So in Mortal Kombat 1. I'm like, man, I would love to look like this guy when I'm 60. No homo, right, Chris? He's like, dude, well, maybe a little bit homo. No problem with that.
What's his name? Joe Taslim or whatever? Sub-Zero?
Yeah.
His eyes are the Bolo eyes.
What do you mean by that?
Like
wide open, like, yeah, yeah.
And they give his eyes, like, you can look into his eyes and see the emotion, and, like, this guy has that same quality.
I think I kind of had two disappointing facts about, you know, about this whole Sub-Zero and Scorpion thing. Sub-Zero was a badass. And like Chris said, you know, he gives off like some crazy intensity in there. And you know, as great as the fight that they did put up, you know, they put up against each other and then Sub-Zero did lose. You know, we as far as playing the games, Sub-Zero does die, but he comes back as another character, which is Noob Saibot. Noob Saibot is actually the name of the creators of this whole Mortal Kombat.
Thank you.
Someone had to say it, right?
Ed Boon and Joe Tobias.
Right. And you spell, you take the two names from both of those and put them backwards, it's like Noob Saibot.
And did you notice the guy they referenced Cole beating back in the day when he would win MMA matches before he started losing, was a guy named John Tobias?
Yeah, I saw that too. With the they were saying about the belt or something, right?
Yep.
Yeah. I saw that in there. I thought it was a good little reference, but my two disappointing facts that I kind of was a little disappointed about was, first off, with Scorpion, he didn't get that much of an appearance with his new powers, with his new hell powers. Because this guy died, and he fought his way out of hell, or the nether realm, to go ahead and just seek revenge because Sub-Zero ended up killing his family. So, you know, like anybody else, they're like, yeah, fuck yeah, I want some damn revenge, you know. So he comes back, and he's helping Cole Young, who's Cole Young is like his descendant. But, anyways, they're both like fighting off Sub-Zero, who's like a really badass fighter. He's like holding him, he's holding his own against both of them. But anyways, we didn't get to see that much throughout the whole damn movie, other than the beginning, how he died, and then the end, you know, just kind of fighting Sub-Zero, which is okay. Well, I kind of wish we would have saw more hell powers. Actually, I was looking forward to him ripping off his mask, and then you see a skeleton, you know, like in the damn video game. He's blowing fire, or even from the 95 yep. version. You know, he ripped off his damn mask, and he's blowing fire at damn giant cage. So, I mean, I wanted to see the whole skeleton thing. I love horror. I love monsters. I love just the way these things look. And I was really looking forward to a Hellspawn, you know, damn scorpion. I was like, shit, yeah, oh, no, he didn't do anything like that. Well, all right, well, it's not over. You know, there's going to be a part two, so maybe we'll see something then. But that was a little bit of a letdown. That was a little bit of a letdown for me, because I didn't get to see the whole skeleton scorpion type of thing.
So, yeah, yeah, I got you on that. Like, I liked exactly what you were saying. Like, when he was taking off the mask, I was waiting for it. Because to me, out of all the fatalities, that was the best one as a kid, was that he takes off his mask and it's like a skull, you know? But it was cool that it still showed that his mouth all the way up to, like, almost to his eyes, it was like this, like, yeah, he was all like, I loved everything that Scorpion said in this film. Like, I had rewatched all the Scorpion parts like numerous times. Go ahead, dude.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt. But, you know, if you look online and if you're looking at like clips of this movie, or anybody like on a Facebook or any type of social media, if you look at the comments and you see the conversations going about Scorpion, apparently a big disappointment that a lot of people I've actually noticed was these people were having was the get over here part. Because you were talking about the quotes, and for him to say get over here, he didn't say it as dramatically or expressed as intensely as like the old 95 one. Get over here! And he's like attacking everything. You know, even in the damn game where he's practically yelling it, in this one he's just like, hey, get... Can you come over here?
Vampaka, yeah. He's like, Vampaka.
Yeah. He didn't say it as intense. I saw a lot of people were making comments about how disappointed they were in that part.
I want you, whenever we're done, you have to go check it out. It's like the trailer, he says it like it's, I guess it's the guy, because he's, you know, really Japanese dub, but he says it like in a Japanese, you know, you could tell his accent. Like, he's like, get over here. You hear the difference. And I liked it. I was like, that's cool, you know, because he's Japanese. And then in the actual movie, it's different than in the trailer. You know, like, it sounds much deeper, and you don't hear as much of an accent. And I was like, wow, it's a big difference. And I actually like the movie the movie version than that. And you'll see the difference. Just watch Mortal Kombat trailer, and you'll hear it towards the end. And then there's Mortal Kombat Sub-Zero scene. And you'll hear him, and he's much deeper, and I love that. It's like, there's no, but yeah, I mean, Ed Boon, I mean, I've seen like those Comic-Con kind of things where he's just there, and you hear him, get over here. You're like, it sounds like, I mean, way, way more authoritative. I mean, cause he's like the originator. That's what we know him as. But I didn't have any problem with the movie version. Scorpion, get over here. It sounded badass to me. That everything about the Scorpion and Sub-Zero shit, I loved. He's fighting with Cole, and he's on the blade of Hanzo, and then, you know, he shows up, get over here, you know, and then they start fighting and all that bullshit, and he's like, I've come back from hell to kill you, like he tells him in Japanese, which I thought was like badass and shit. He's like, not many people could say that.
And I burned in the fires of hell, then I learned to control them.
Yeah, and then he like takes off his mask, he's like, do you remember this face? And all kinds of, like, just all that's just good stuff for, like, you know, before you're going to drop the leg on somebody, you just kind of, like, start, you know, jab them and right-hand them. So I loved all that shit, you know. But, yeah, I mean, I agree.
Wasn't that shit so creative with the damn blood? He took his blood, froze it, and then turned it into a damn weapon. Like, honestly, like, if I had Sub-Zero's damn powers and I was fighting fucking Scorpion or Cole Young or whatever, and there's no way I would have thought of, like, oh, shit, a chunk of blood. Let me freeze that shit and just, you know, use that as a damn weapon, too.
I'd be like, I'm never going to have a warm drink again. I'll tell you that right now. I'll tell you that right now. Yeah. Yeah, they're going to be cold-ass margaritas from here on out. But yeah, no, I loved all the Scorpion and Sub-Zero scenes. I mean, their fight was what made everything. That whole beginning, like, you kind of knew what was going to happen already, just because, you know, if you saw the trailer, you're like, well, Scorpion has to turn into Scorpion somehow, so I guess he's going to get his ass kicked, you know. And it was kind of like, that was, to me, for a while, like, the best scene in the movie until we got to some of the Scorpion scenes. Whenever Liu Kang was around, it kind of felt like a disappointment. Kung Lao was the shit. Before we go, you know, everyone's like, where's Johnny Cage? And then Chris, you know, did you pop when you saw the Johnny Cage movie poster at the end? I'm going to go get somebody.
Fuck yeah.
That you're like, is that Joey Cage's brother?
Yeah. Joey Cage.
Winks at Rose.
Joey Cage, Danny Cage, the other Danny Cage that runs the wrestling school, Christian Cage, the wrestler. Yeah, I popped.
It's pretty good, huh? So, dude, did you notice that, Gabe, when they saw the Johnny Cage one? You see the Johnny Cage poster and the big old belt buckle?
I did, but honestly, like, the game, the movie, Johnny Cage is, like, one of my least favorite characters. I don't know. I never really enjoyed that character at all. I was just like, no, he's just not that great. It was pretty, I think the only
How dare you, that one little girl. You know who I'm talking about, right, Chris? That whatever chick from Europe. You've stolen my childhood. No?
No.
Go ahead.
I don't know. The only cool thing about Johnny Cage was, if you played the damn video game, he had his friendship. It that was like, instead of a fatality, sometimes they had the option where you can do different endings. You didn't have to kill off your character. They had a thing called friendships. Mm-hmm. So you would do that, and they would all have, like, if you did Cyrax, which is one of the characters, which he was a robot, if you did a friendship with him, I remember he did, like, a little shuffle dance. And if you were Shang Tsung and you did it, all of a sudden he made a rainbow instead of killing you off or taking your soul.
Yeah, I remember that.
You know, and Johnny Cage would go ahead and he would sign an autograph, a little selfie photograph of himself, and he'll go ahead and throw it to you and say, "Huh, to my biggest fan."
Yeah.
And it says friendship. I was like, what the hell? So he did that in the old 95 movie, and I thought that was the funniest shit ever. And, you know.
Yeah, that was like when that shit happened, I popped for that shit too, when he did the whole to my biggest fan. Some bullshit.
How dare you? I just remembered I had you on me, but how dare you, Greta Thunberg? I should be in school. Instead, you're talking silly fantasies of money.
Yeah, that's it, Greta. Yeah, it's like, how dare you? When he was trashing, you know, Johnny Cage, I'm like, how dare you? You have stolen my childhood. Yeah, I've always liked Johnny Cage because he's the cool guy, dude. He's got the sunglasses on, dude. I mean, fuck, he got six dogs that don't wink at me. You know, it's like, I mean, come on now. What are we doing here, right, Chris? But I thought the
95 movie presented Johnny Cage well. Like, it's exactly the story you should tell with a guy like that, because he's the Jean-Claude Van Damme martial arts movie star fancy schmancy guy, but he's having to go up against Scorpion, Sub-Zero, guys like that.
Yeah, and you know, and you're right. You know, he was good, but honestly,
no, it's too late now to say you like Johnny Cage. It's way too late. We're way past that. Yeah. I'm just kidding.
No, but I mean, like, the only reason why I'm watching Mortal Kombat, I'm playing the games, I'm doing all this, not just because of the damn fatalities, because of how brutal it is, but the damn characters. I mean, you got a damn Raiden who's, like, all thunder and electricity. You got Sub-Zero, he's all blue, looks like a damn ninja. They all have, like, their own little shtick. Like, they all, and honestly, Johnny Cage is just like a, you know, just like another average Joe guy. I'm like, oh man, you know, if the whole game just had a whole bunch of fatalities, but everybody looked similar to Johnny Cage, I honestly would not be playing this or have any attention to that game whatsoever. Even though the fatalities are there, I mean, if all the characters ended up looking something similar to Johnny Cage, just like your average Joe, it's it would just be like boring to me. I'm just like, oh, I just don't want to play with any of them. You know, even and they even tried to spruce them up. I think it was Mortal Kombat X. They ended up putting tattoos all over them. I was like, oh, great. Now he's like a freaking gang member or something like that. He's all hood now. And I was like, no, no.
How dare you?
He's like, yeah, you can't spruce up garbage. I'm from carnal. Yeah, you can only put like so much lipstick on a pig. I mean, shit. That character sucks ass.
What the fuck are we doing here? Jesus, he's like, I like Johnny Cage. He goes, only so much lipstick you can put on a pig. God dang.
Well, he's relentless.
How much have you had to drink tonight, Gabe? How much have you had to drink tonight? I'm just kidding.
Oh, right now I'm all hopped up on Dr. Pepper right now.
Snacks.
That's Dr. Yeah, Pepper talking.
But that's what I said. Like, when we were fifth graders playing Mortal Kombat 1, yeah, we were all like, why does anybody care about this Johnny Cage guy?
All
he does is go straight for the nuts. Anybody who's playing with Johnny Cage goes straight for the nuts.
He does a split and punch you in the nuts. But in the context of the 95 movie, where they have him as this movie star being put in real combat against his guy, then he's like the underdog baby face and you're cheering for him.
It's funny.
The underdog that goes for your nuts.
That
guy sucks ass.
No, yeah, when you were saying that, like, when you were a kid, well, yeah, when I was a kid, like, it's all about Sub-Zero and then Scorpion. And then even Kano, just because he looked like the Terminator, you know? So I was like, the only one I didn't play was Sonya, because I'm a dude. But I like Johnny Cage because he had sunglasses. It was like, well, you have the Bruce Lee lookalike with Liu Kang, you know, the guy wearing all the outfit the same way. And then you have, you know, Johnny Cage. He's the guy. He's the cool guy, dude. So I right away was like, well, yeah, Johnny Cage is cool. I wouldn't always pick him because they didn't really, like, find the character till like, part two, because he started wearing the pants and all that other shit, you know, looking cool the way I do with my Puma pants. So, I mean, there.
Johnny Cage was not my character. Sucked ass. I don't wanna bother with that character at all. And anybody whoever I played throughout all my damn years.
Anyone that ever said Johnny Cage?
Yeah, anybody, I kid you not, everybody had their own stick, but anybody who ever picked Johnny Cage always went for my nuts. It didn't even matter what. They always tried. I was like, I knew exactly what they're gonna do. I blocked it every damn time. But it's so stupid. That character sucks ass.
Sounds like you had a traumatic experience, you know, with this Johnny Cage character. Oh, J-Man, dude, tell us. You know what? No, I want you to go first. You know what? Let me. I'm gonna turn the tables on myself. I'm gonna go first. You didn't see that one coming, did you, Rose? So for me, Mortal Kombat 2021, dude. What am I gonna rate it? What I think about it overall? It's a solid ass 7.3 out of 10 for me. I really enjoyed the film. It's a ton of fun. There's a lot of like things that I wish would have been different. It's like when you compare this to the original, I love the original still. Like, I'll still watch it. Like, you know, like if you watch Nightmare on Elm Street 1 and then the remake, you're like, well, I'm always going to watch the original. There's some people who always watch the remake. This is one where I enjoy watching both, you know, because they both have their strengths and flaws. There's not one that I just kind of like, whatever. This one looks really good. The story from the original was really, you know, I said already, really well, done really well. The characters are really good. So I enjoy both a lot. It's one that I'll come back to every once in a while. Not like, oh my God, but it's good. It's a lot better than average. The visuals, of course, were in 2021. The other one was made, 1995-ish or whatever. I mean, of course, it's not going to look as good, but that's how good that film is that I'll still go back to it, and it might be a little bit better than this one. So they should, you know, see about making Robin Cho, you know, Chris's boyfriend, as the new Shang Tsung in the in part two. But that's how I feel about it. But Christopher J, dude, go ahead.
I'm gonna give this one a 7.5 out of 10. It was fun. I enjoyed it. Story wise, character wise, whatever, a lot of flaws and like you said, a few things I wish they would have done differently. I think the presentation of Raiden was excellent. I think Liu Kang was cool, but they didn't get the character over the way they should have, especially earlier on. Kung Lao was fucking awesome. Sub-Zero was just this the irony of Sub-Zero getting heat, you know, but anyway, as a heel, anyway, wrestling joke, anyway. But they left me with a lot of hope for, you know, as this being an origin story, they left me with a lot of hope at the end of how part two is going to feel a lot more like what I think the 95 one is, and I'm really looking forward to what they do with part two, probably, what, 2022, 2023? And, yeah, I mean, I saw the 10 clips of the 95 one. I thought that was a better story, but I still like this one. It's fun. I enjoyed it, but it's, like I said, a lot of inconsistencies, a lot of illogicalness, and a lot of character development I thought they could have done better at, so I'm going to give it a 7.5.
Good shit. Gabe?
Yep. Man, I'm right with you all on this. Damn 7. I'll give it 7.5. I love the costumes. The characters were great. The fight scenes were pretty badass. You know, pretty bloody, it was pretty gory. You know, I would not have a problem, you know, if someone mentioned they want to sit down and watch this movie, I'd be like, yeah, you know, I'll go ahead and watch this movie again. But yeah, it's my only disappointment is that I was expecting the tournament already. Instead, it's more build up for part two, which, you know, okay, I agree with. You know, that's fine. It's understandable. But honestly, I was waiting for the tournament because I want to see everybody go one-on-one with each other. I wanted to see the Sub-Zero Scorpion, which we did. But, I mean, I wanted to see it start from, you know, scratch, not two-on-one or, you know, all this other. I wanted to see one-on-one. I want to see these people fight. So, 7.5. That's what I'm going with.
Yeah, it felt like there was a lot to, you know, to still want in this film. You like you said, it's like, oh yeah, it's like a Jason movie, right? Friday the 13th. It's just like, yeah, it's just one. Yeah, let's just relax and watch a fuck. If you're into a horror movie kind of night, let's watch part two or three or whatever the fuck. It felt like one of those, like, we're just going to have fun and just enjoy ourselves. This is the way this. Like, you, of course, you have problems with it. Like, oh come on, don't do that. Don't do this. Kind of the same kind of deal. Like I said, the original is great actors and all that, but yeah, we're a horror movie kind of podcast, and like all the gore and all kinds of fights and blood, it's like, it's fun, it's a fun film. So yeah, I'll come back to it for sure. But anyways, we'll eventually get to the original soon. We don't know what we're gonna do yet. I'm gonna try and convince these guys to do it. We're kind of a head-on podcast here, so we have plenty of time to think about it. But I hope you guys
convince me on that. That's a solid one.
Hope you guys enjoyed this one, and we'll see you on the next one.
Man, you gotta be shooting me. That mother's strong.
Peace.